Welcome back to Black Girl Couch Reviews. I'm your host, Christina. We're back to discuss the third episode in the first season of From Choosing Day, written by John Griffin, directed by Jack Bender. Another good episode. We get a little bit more exploration of those in the town. For the most part, we wrapped up the Frank storyline, which introduced us to the tragedy, the only one they've had in quite some time. And now they are adding additional elements to the mystery that continues to pull me in every time I watch an episode. I might have to push this up to two episodes a week because I'm so all in. Even though it was more of a character exploration, I still, for the most part, was enjoying the journey. Kind of sad where Frank ended up, but I feel like he got the justice he himself felt he deserved. And Jade, man, Jade was kind of a comedic relief, but he was certainly, I'm glad we were all annoyed with him at the breaking point where, okay, I can understand you reacting this way, particularly you being the person that you are, very entitled, arrogant, probably used to being serviced quite often. And I do mean like having people do things for you, not necessarily sexually. I don't know why my mind just immediately went there and I felt the need to course correct. But rolling on, I certainly find myself at the end of every episode really excited to get into the next one. A little disappointed by the difference between the colony house because it feels very much like I suspected it would feel, but there was no elaboration on it other than apparently these people are all in the carpe diem, take one day at a time. But they have rules. Clearly, they have their own ways of protecting. Or are they more like, we don't look out for each other. Everyone's on their own. It's a hard knock life. I'm not quite sure. Other than the loosening of rules, it being the hippie house that I expected, then they double down on that with the herbal indulgence, sex in the middle of the living room where everyone is sleeping, including the Matthews. Kind of confirmed it. Tabitha is having a bad dream. Her husband, Jim, comforts her. She was having a bad dream, though, about the blank faces eerily creeping towards her instead of rolling over in that RV down an embankment, because that personally would have given me PTSD, especially as you were injured more so than anyone else, well, other than your son, in that accident. Jade wakes screaming for Toby.
Stop talking. Be quiet for several days.
I am questioning what kind of relationship he and Toby had. Was it a best friends type of thing? Was it a personal assistant type of thing? Or was it romantic? Donna comes in to deal with the situation. Boyd wakes at his home in the sheriff's office, or his bed in the sheriff's office, and stares out at an outbuilding with a very ominous expression before checking on Frank, who is locked up, has been for the last couple of days awaiting his punishment. He admits to Boyd that Lauren admired him for being a leader, making the hard choices, and being the best hope at getting them out of there.
Under pressure. Under pressure.
Frank knows his punishment is not personal. Very much feels as if Boyd doesn't want to do it despite putting a gun to the back of his head a few days ago, but the deaths were pretty fresh. He states that he always wasn't like this, to which Boyd replies, none of us were. Jade isn't taking the news of his new reality seriously, only thinking this is an elaborate escape town funded by the deceased Toby. So he's left to wander by himself before hijacking a girl's bike.
Stolen.
This town is not that big. I would have tracked down my bicycle and had a baseball bat with me to beat the shit out of him. Like, next time, I'm not going to let you get the chance. Ethan is ready to get out of bed so he can play with his invisible friend outside, who only stalks outside his window waving back in all white. While Julie is back to acting like a typical teenage girl, more worried about her parents going through her stuff than the fact that she is stuck here now. Something Ethan hasn't really grasped yet, being so young. Mom goes to get him breakfast and tries to assure him. Kenny's mom, Tian Chun, focuses on her work, but it's clear she is distressed, dropping a glass and then cutting herself. She is racked with guilt, but Kenny tells her the best thing for her now is to rest and to not open the restaurant slash diner slash food hall that they have. She's the one that does all the cooking. She's putting all of her energy into that rather than processing the fact that her husband is now gone. She's alone, and she hadn't even accepted that he had dementia. I appreciated showing them speaking in their dialect and then not showing us some of the subtext in the subtitles when they're speaking to each other in a couple of scenes. Sarah, a waitress and Lou's murderer, comes to be of assistance. Victor takes out a school lunchbox and begins counting steps into the woods next to Colony House. He feels like he's been here since childhood, so I have question mark next to him. Fatima befriends Julie just as Father Kachi arrives to let them know about the choosing ceremony, the parents, which is selecting where they will live, Colony House or in town. She is tasked with babysitting, and since she's really tired of that life and now has the perfect out and group of people that will stick by her rebellious decision, she decides to take it out on them later on. Meanwhile, Jade continues to remain self-centered and oblivious to the line of people waiting for food, believing it's all for him, no matter how annoyed everyone looks by his behavior. Kenny's mom also isn't against violence. She was like, I will beat the shit out of you with this freaking, what was that, a hand mixer? Sarah forces her brother Nathan away from the diner, assuring him that she's fine, that she has to continue to act normal despite her mental condition, saying she's everything but. And apparently Nathan's that, I wonder if there's some type of incest going on, because I'm still freaking out about her coming out of that shower in a wet towel before she admitted to murder and him being totally chill. Like, he's not even struggling with the preacher saying, like, man, there's something that got on my chest and, man, I'm struggling with it. He's like, no, I'll go back down and work in the fields. Father Khatri explains the structure Boyd was staring at is called the box. It's their only form of punishment for breaking the rules that lead to someone else's death, and that it recently happened. One is left there overnight without a talisman for the ultimate judgment, which no one's going to survive. He thinks to make a case for staying in town by showing them the home, their future home, which also happens to be the crime scene of Lauren and Megan's death, with all manner of blood and other biological materials just still freshly there for them to ponder upon. Y'all ain't got a hazmat team or something. You could have put up some yellow tape. He just walked him in there like, this is the consequences of the actions and why our punishment is so cruel. Tabitha, he didn't even look regretful of just walking them in the middle of a horrific scene like that. Tabitha doesn't want to accept that this is their new life, especially as they are told that the children are the most vulnerable to get the monsters to let them in. But Jim reminds her that he had his moment of disbelief and now it's about protecting our kids and snapping out of, why is this happening to me? And if the man who should have been protecting his family passed out drunk, leaving his kid and wife vulnerable to mutilation, then he deserves that box. I have a feeling he might be the next deputy. Kenny's feeling fatigued. He might want to go into the business of helping his mom at the diner. Or anything else. Boy, give me Frank. His last request takes him to where he built Megan's swing with Boyd agreeing to bury him next to them. And despite his stoicism, he is shattered. He doesn't want to do this. Julie, with the meanest look, watches Ellis gift her brother Ethan with some crutches and help him down the stairs. She wonders why Fatima is being a human being to her, like she's never heard of kindness from black or brown people, which makes me feel some kind of way about Julie. I mean, I could be completely, I mean, she's probably wrong. She's probably met plenty, but her reactions to things feel like she's been sheltered in the Oregon Trail somewhere. Jade is struggling with the logic, which is crazy because I feel like her mother is more Hispanic. Like, she's got a little something to her, some spicy, some salsa, right? Jade is struggling with the logic of this elaborate scheme despite being given the lowdown and is told by Kenny, who is privy to this mess unfolding in front of him, that the cows and chickens apparently appear mysteriously out of nowhere and they haven't figured that out. So someone wants to make sure that the feed, which is them, are actually fed. Christy visits Kenny to check up on him and get some physical affection. Victor is pestered by Ethan, asking him a lot of questions. It was only three. That was cute. After hearing about the boy, though, because he says you need to go away because then I'm the one that's always blamed just for being myself and being here because I look creepy because I'm clearly just mentally stunted by the fact that I've been here since childhood, which she calls anyone who hears that to be empathetic because he didn't get to grow up like a normal human being. Hence why he would be a little less socially adapted. And he'll get blamed and then he'll get no peaches. It's the only thing he wants is no peaches. He's like, I'll get cursed out by Donna and I'm not trying to deal with this. So just go away. But he's like, do you know that little boy who lives around here? He's like, what little boy? But you know what? Since you know that little boy and I need to know more about that and figure out why he ain't talking to me no more, which is what I felt like. He fills him in on what he's doing. He's checking to see if the trees have moved. Why are the trees moving? I do not know. It's interesting and duly noted. He also, though, sends his well wishes to Ethan's newfound friend. And I'm wondering, did Victor know this boy when he was a kid? Julie comes out, quickly growing into the cunt that she was meant to be. She does get it from her mama, though, because her mama be going off. Like, I'm not letting her stay up in that house. Now, if she would have mentioned or taken note of the fact that they were smoking a lot of reefer, God knows what else could be going on in there, and that they were just having sex all out in the open, I can see why she would not want her teenage daughter to just, but they don't really go into how old she is. Is she 17? Is she 15? I don't know. But I know if my 17-year-old was like, I want to live over there. I mean, you 1 year away from college. At this point, it's kind of stupid for you to be old enough. So. But she also did trust them more quickly. Like, I don't understand why she took such a dislike to Donna. Because she what? Tied you up and made sure you were. I still don't understand why you wouldn't realize, oh, I would do the same thing in that situation. But she clearly dislikes her, but not for the reasons that have been stated, instead for all of the reasons that she shouldn't have a problem with her. She tells her brother not to talk to him again because he's creepy. He fits all the stereotypes, but take into account that people have been stuck here, your empathy, well, you're also at the age where you don't and barely know what empathy is. Jade, still riding his stolen merchandise, comes upon a, what do you call these things? Because I've never been anywhere, lived anywhere where I had one. A storage, some type of storage hatch, storm shelter, I don't know. But he sees this gutted out body there, scared the shit out of me for a second. Then a symbol on the ceiling before there's nothing, and thus rides back into town, laughing maniacally.
I'm in denial.
I made a joke at this moment in my notes that he and the widow Lou would be soulmates, since they really be sipping on the denial juice. Boyd goes to Father Kashi to absolve him of needing to stand by his conviction of putting Frank in the box for his crimes, but Kashi rightly points out that the rules won't hold up if they aren't held up. You built a guillotine in the middle of town square. What happens when the townspeople realize you lack the conviction to use it? He calls him a terrible priest before dropping many F-bombs in the house of the Lord and wondering why he's dropping so many F-bombs in the house of the Lord. Next, he sits in the place of Frank's fate and cannot go through with it, so he lets the man out, gives him a talisman, and simply banishes him to the woods and tells him to try to make a life there. As the choosing ceremony begins, Boyd is about to announce he banished Frank when the man himself shows up to admit that he was a good father. He recalls the last Christmas he had with his family before they ended up here, and that he lost sight of what was most important to him by letting their situation and the creatures out there get to him, and wants nothing more than to join his girls, feeling the torture is appropriate. Even the townspeople are like, well, maybe you shouldn't make this decision when you're grieving. But he knows, no, you guys need to take care of each other, and what I did was wrong, and I should suffer for it. Jade laughs at that moment at the unfolding drama, so Boyd gets angry and physical.
Who the fuck you think you fucking with? I'm the police. I run shit here. You just live here.
They call Boyd sheriff, so I'm wondering if he was a police officer in his former life. He demands that he choose. He does, choosing to live in town before being shoved to Kenny, to show him the dead body to shake him out of his rudeness. Julie chooses not to select staying with her parents because she's a twat, choosing to stay with Fatima and hating her family because she needs someone to blame, I guess, but
fucking kids!
It's not meant to be rational, and then her being like, well, then I'm going to stay with my daughter, and he just said this is final. I feel like in 5 minutes, you are allowing all of your authority to be overruled. Even though I laughed so loud when he told Donna to shut the fuck up. Which is true, though. Like, why are you a grown-ass woman rubbing in a teenager's rebellion? You know the best place for her is her family. Especially at a time of crisis like this. But because she apparently just wants a new recruit, or just wants to stick it to him in the town ways, she's just deciding that's a good moment to circumvent a mother's true worry for her child, even though she needed to stop acting like a little, I don't know. Like, she also has problems with, I feel like her mother's acting just as rude as the daughter. But she decided to side with the other people, even though that's where Victor lives. So that's kind of crazy to me that you are willing to live in a house with Victor, but you don't feel safe in a house with him in it. Kind of strange. Frank is let into the box with him begging the sheriff to get these people home. Montage begins of everyone heading home with Jade. Well, the jukebox, does that come on every night by itself, or was that just a nice way to start the montage? Jade is staying with Kenny and his mom, who's grieving. And they'll probably be friends because they have things to grieve together. They have two losses. And unfortunately, despite Frank putting his dukes up, he does not make it.
I tried so hard and got so far, but in the end, it doesn't even matter.
That is the end of the episode. I don't know what could possibly be going on. I have no, other than this could be like some cursed town where the people who used to live here are like stuck in some pocket dimension of time and now have to live out the rest of their lives as these demons. But why? Why? And how do these other people all randomly make it here? Is there any correlation with the amount of people? Well, that can't be, because three people died and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 people came in. So that doesn't math up for me. I have no idea what's going on. And I like learning just enough about each person in each situation. And now we're going to have to deal with the family that are going to have to also accumulate to the many other weird things that are happening, because these are only the things that we've been told about. If you want to send feedback for our next episode, blackgirlcouch@gmail.com, or you can leave a comment below. My social media will be there as well. Like, share, subscribe. Until the next time, peace, hair grease, and blacker magic.
Que será, será. What will be, will be. When I grew